How can you forgive me when I've often gone astray? How can you think of me when I think my way, turning my back from you, the one who loved me first, having my
Hey, good evening, Messiah family. This is Pastor Rod. This is November the 3rd. It's 2020 election night, and normally we don't have Bible study on election night, but I just suspect that we could all use a word of encouragement. And so tonight I'm sharing with you a message that I've shared at Messiah Community Church called Encourage Yourself. In these challenging times, we need to learn how to encourage ourselves and to know that we can rejoice no matter what the outcome of the election is going to be. It's not easy, but it is possible. We're trusting in a great God, and we're going to encourage ourselves. Be encouraged. God is still in control.
To be joyful is a choice that you and I can make. I didn't want to preach this because I didn't even want to live it. I just felt if I wanted to sulk, if I wanted to be sad, if I wanted to be discouraged, if I wanted to be mad, I should have the right to be mad anytime I want to be mad. If I just wanted to be low, I want somebody to join my pity party and feel low with me, and don't we have a right to feel down about what's going on in our lives? Somebody shout no. Paul commands us to rejoice. He commands us to summon the joy of God. He says, I will rejoice in the Lord. He says, when I think about all that God has done for me, when I think about all that he is in my life, when I think about the doors that he's opened and the ways that he's made and the provision that God has brought into my life, how could I not still be joyful? Paul says, I might be in prison, but God is still God. God is still God. He says that the stars are not going to fall out of the sky. God is still God. The earth is not going to stop spinning because God is still God. If God got me the last job, God will get me another job. If God paid my mortgage last month, God will pay my mortgage next month. Who am I preaching to in this place? I came to tell somebody this morning, lift up your heads, O ye gates. Paul says, rejoice in the Lord always. That means that there's never a circumstance that I cannot overcome with the joy of God. Amen. Ooh, this is good stuff right here. Yes. Paul says, rejoice in the Lord. Did you know you have control over your feelings? Yeah. Did you know you get to command your emotions? I feel a revelation coming onto somebody's life right now. You get to tell your emotions, shut up right now. I'm not fitting to wallow in sadness. You're going to stop this right now. No, I'm not going to be depressed. I'm not going to be worried. I'm not going to be anxious. I rejoice in God, my Savior. If God, ooh, y'all forgive me, I'm getting ahead of myself. If Jesus gave everything that he gave for me, how will he not also, Romans says, freely give us all things? He says he's going to give me everything I need. He says, apply it all. How can I not rejoice? Is anybody feeling the freedom of God right now to just walk in the joy of the Lord? Tell your neighbor, you got to make yourself happy. You got to stop waiting for somebody to turn your situation around and come and slap you on your back and tell you it's going to be okay. We all need encouragement, but you might have to encourage yourself in the Lord and choose joy, choose to rejoice, choose to clap yourself happy. By the way, one of the reflections on the word to be joyful or to rejoice is to clap. And it could suggest to you that if you would just begin to clap. That's why so often when we come into the worship service, what's the first thing I'll say to you? Clap to the Lord. Clap to the Lord. Clapping makes you feel happy. When you begin to celebrate God, you begin to feel better. When you begin to praise him, and when you begin to bless him, and when you begin to thank him, don't you just feel better? Somebody just clap to God and rejoice in the Lord always. Has he been good to you? Has he made a way out of no way? Has he been faithful to you? Have I got one witness? You ought to stand on your feet and give God a big clap. and celebrate God and rejoice in Him. Lord, thank you that my car note is paid. Lord, thank you that there's still gas in the car. God, thank you that there's food in the refrigerator. Thank you that I got a roof over my head. Thank you that I got a church to go and worship God. Thank you that I got clothes on my body. Thank you that I got a reasonable portion of my health and my strength. I still am clothed and in my right mind. God, I got a reason to bless you. I got a reason to clap to you. I will be joyful in the Lord. My God. Y'all sit down. I'm getting too far ahead of myself. I got a lot to preach. Sit on that. Sit down. Sit down. Sit down. Paul says, rejoice in the Lord always. He says, let your gentleness be evident to all. I love this part of the text. He says, people need to know that you got a real connection with God. People need, in other words, when you got a reason to be stressed and a reason to be anxious, he says, let your gentleness be evident. Let them see that you're not wigging out. Because y'all know what stress does. No, y'all don't know what stress does. Y'all never had stress to make you want to cuss each other out. You never been there. But I'm here to tell the truth and shame the devil on your behalf and on mine. Paul says, let people see your gentleness. People need to know that God is real in your life. Just let your gentleness be evident to all. He says, the Lord is near. He says, here's why you can, God is near. God hadn't left you. God hadn't drifted off into outer space somewhere as if he has no idea what you're dealing with and what you're going through. God knows exactly where you are. He's just a prayer away. He's just waiting to step right into your situation. He is sitting right by you, and he knows exactly what you need. Here's his next command to us, and I've really structured this message around each of the imperatives, the commands. He says in verse 6, do not be anxious about anything. Don't you love that? He says, first of all, rejoice always. Don't be anxious ever about anything, about no one thing is what it literally means. He says, don't be anxious. Don't be worried about anything. This is real important. Paul says, anxiety is a posture that we choose. And it becomes for many of us a default mode. Can we talk about anxiety? Because we've been led to believe that anxiety is a disorder that you just have to live with. I'm going to punch the devil right in his face this morning. Is the feeling of anxiety real? Absolutely. But Paul says, don't be. He commands us, do not be anxious about any single thing. Jesus says, do not worry. Matthew chapter 6. He said, don't worry. He commanded the disciples on three, maybe four occasions in that passage in Matthew 6. He says, do not worry. Did you know God told you don't worry? Some of us feel like if we worry about it, we make stuff better. Yeah, what you doing? I'm just worrying about my life. I'm just sitting here worrying. I'm trying to worry some stuff into order. I'm trying to worry some stuff back together, and because I feel like if I worry about it, I can actually fix it. Jesus says, did you not know that worrying about anything does not add a single day to your life? As a matter of fact, worrying will take a few days off your life. Oh my God. I don't know about you, but I'm trying to stick around as long as I can and do as much as I can. And he says that if we will succumb to worry and to anxiety, we actually will shorten our lives. Paul says, don't be anxious. Jesus says, don't worry. Let's talk about worry and anxiety. Can we talk about that for a little bit? Worry is not an emotion. Revelation. Wham. Worry is not an emotion. Worry is a preoccupation. It is to take something that you are concerned about. I love what Dr. Tony Evans says. He says it's a concern on steroids. To worry is to take something and let it begin to magnify in your life so that you keep focusing on it and it just keeps getting bigger. And so you take what could be a legitimate concern, watch this now, and then you begin to assume that you have the power to control the thing that you're worried about. And so the worry becomes anxiety and the anxiety becomes fear. And Jesus says, don't worry about it. Paul says, don't be anxious about it. He says, because you can't control anything. You can't even control you half the time. You're worried about your children. You can't control your children. Let me just help somebody out. You can whoop them, and I pray you will. For my sake, just whoop your children. Just on GP. You're 6 years old, and folly is bound up in the heart of a child. I'm just going to whoop you, but you can't control them. You can't control their future. You can't control their destiny. You have no... You can't control if pink slips get handed out tomorrow at work. You can't control who stays with you. You can't control who leaves you. If they choose to stay with you, great. If they don't want to be with you, great. Let them go. My God, who is this for this morning? You can't control any of that. Stop worrying about, you can't control what people think about you. I wonder what they think. I bet they think. They must think. I'm not going to say that. Forget about what they think. You can't control what people think about you. You keep posturing yourself and trying to situate yourself so that people see you in the best light. You can be as beautiful and as kind and as capable as you want, but haters are going to hate. Worry is a preoccupation with things that you cannot control. It is not an emotion. Stop talking about, I feel worried. You don't feel worried. You choose to worry. Don't we all? I'm having a conversation with myself. Y'all understand what I'm saying? Here's the thing. The more you discover that you can't control it, what happens is the more anxiety sets in. I can't control this. Yeah, so y'all know how crazy we are, right? I'm talking we. This is a we. There's you and me. The more we realize we're not in control of stuff, what do? The more we try to control it. Anxiety is an expression, all that jitteriness and that. Can I come sit with y'all? They're not feeling me today. You all over the place. Because the more you discover you can't control something, the more we try to control it. And the more you try to control it, the more elusive it becomes, which means the more anxious you feel. And Paul says, do not be anxious about a single thing. And what are you anxious about today? I want you to write it down, as a matter of fact. You already know what you're anxious about. You already know what you've been worried about. I want you to write it down, because we're going to have a moment where you're going to surrender it to God. Proverbs chapter 12, verse 25 says, anxiety in the heart of a man causes depression, but a good word makes it glad. Oh my God. Anybody need a good word in your life? Somebody thank the Lord for a good word. You didn't even have to make an appointment with your therapist today. You just came to the house of the Lord and you got a good word, something to bind the anxiety, something to come against the fear, something to come against the worry. Anxiety in the heart of a man depresses him. The more anxiety sits in your spirit, the more depressed you become. The depression is because you lose any resolve that your circumstances can change, and you know that you can't control it. And so the natural reaction in your physical being is to begin to feel depressed. Now, let me just throw this out since we're here. This is not a suggestion that medication is not helpful and even necessary. Can we talk for real? Don't go home and say, Pastor said, get rid of my medicine. Somebody just look around. You say, Pastor did not say, don't take your medication. Oh, y'all not gonna help me preach in here. I said, y'all wanna fake the funk for a minute. Here's all we're saying. The medication is helpful, but the medication can only mask. It can only mask the symptoms, so that what it is designed to do is to address how you feel, but it is not designed to get to the root of why you're there. And what I love about the Word of God is God has a way of getting to the root of the problem, so that you begin to practice some truth in your life to get you to the root of the issue. Keep taking the medication, but work on the root. When you go to see your therapist, say, I got to get to the root of this. I want to know, why am I anxious? I want to know, why am I worried? I want to know, what is it that I'm trying to control that I've discovered that I can't control? I'll talk about money next week. Y'all will feel better. You're like, not really. Here's the next principle Paul gives us. Paul says, do not be anxious about anything, but in every situation, by prayer and petition, with thanksgiving, present your requests to God. Here it is. Request what you need from God. So much of our anxiety and our worry is about things that we legitimately need. I need to have my needs met. Come on, somebody. I need some good friends in my life. I need some people in my life who love me and who will care about me. We need those things. Am I right about it? That there's some things that we need, and Paul says, don't be anxious about it, but in every situation, by prayer and petition. One translation says, by prayer and supplication. Paul says, you can begin to address the root of the anxiety and the worry with a prayer life. I thought I was in church. I thought I would get about 100 people who would just bless the Lord and say, Pastor, I have found out that if I pray about it, if I take it to the Lord in prayer, that it still works, like the old church used to say. Paul says, if you want to overwhelm what's overwhelming you, take the thing, the need, the issue to prayer. Prayer is simply, this word is perhaps the most generic term for invoking a deity. Paul says you can get it out of your life if you will talk to your God about the thing that's going on in it. And I think this is very important, because so often we think about what we ought to be praying about. But if you will talk about what you've been thinking about, and if you will bring that thing to God, he says, now you begin to address the issue. You begin to cut it off at the knees, because you're now bringing it not to just any deity, but you are bringing it literally to the God who can do something about your situation. Somebody shout, pray about it. Pray about it. Talk to God about it. Open your mouth and bless God about it. Say, God, I need to talk to you about something. I need to give something to you, God. I've been holding this thing. I've been worrying about this thing. I've been sitting up late at night running this thing through my mind. How am I going to work this out? And how am I going to work that out? And how am I going to change this? And how am I going to fix this? But God, I haven't talked to you about the thing that I've been thinking about. Somebody shout, talk to God about it. That's why one of the most important things we do when we come to the house of the Lord is to have prayer, so we can talk to God about what we're dealing with, what we're going through. And can I just park a couple other things on you? Like, stop being so cute like you ain't going through nothing. Sometimes I say, all right, it's time for us to pray, and we get in a circle. I want you to pray with two or three people. You don't have to like them. You don't have to know them. Y'all know I say that all the time, right? Now share what you need from God. Well, I just need a new tire for my car. You lying. You need some peace that passes all understanding. You need some money. You need God to fix your marriage. You need God. Somebody shout, stop being cute. Yeah, we ain't got time for that. Do not be anxious about anything, but in every situation, by prayer and petition, supplication is the word, or petition. It literally means to make demands of God. That's pretty powerful. It is to bring God the request, but it is to make a demand of him, and it is not to make a command of God or to say, God, you're going to fix my situation. It is to say to God, God, I can't fix this, and so I'm bringing it to you, and I'm asking you to fix it, so I'm going to make a demand on you by virtue of your power, by virtue of the fact that you are sovereign, by virtue of the fact that you are the omnipotent God, by virtue of the fact that there is nothing impossible for you. I'm going to place some demands on your extraordinary nature, because I know that you're still the God who can cause the seas to get calm. You're still the God who can cause life to shine in the darkness. I'm going to make a demand on a great God, because I can't do anything with it. I know that you can. See, the demand is placed in the right light. Watch this now. He says, by prayer and petition with thanksgiving. He says, if you'll thank God while you're making a demand of God, you will never become entitled toward God. Sometimes we come to God in prayer, and God, you just, I need you to do such and such, I need you to do such and such, and I command. No, shut up. You ain't commanding God to do nothing. God, I know that you can. I know that you're able. And Lord, I want to thank you right now that no matter how it works out, no matter when you turn the table on this situation, I'm going to give you the thanks in advance. I'm going to thank you for what you can do. I'm going to thank you for what you have done. I'm going to thank you because I know that no matter how it goes, you're still in control. You're going to work this thing out. Have I got a witness in this place? Has anybody discovered that God is worthy to be thanked long before he works the situation out? He may not work it out when I want him to, but I have found out, somebody said, that he is an on-time God. Oh, yes, he is. May not come when you want him, but he still will be there right on time. Anybody got a thanks for God? Thank him for the thing he did last week, and thank him for the thing he did last month, and thank him for the thing that he's going to do next week, and next month, and next year. Somebody give God a thank you praise and tell him, Lord, I thank you that you've already gone ahead of me. I thank you that you have seen the beginning and you have seen the end. I thank you that you're in control and you are in charge. Sufficient for every need. My God, I dare you to park your car on the side of the road one day and just say, God, I'm here to thank you for what you're going to do. I don't know what devil I got to face when I get to work, but I thank you that demons flee at the name of Jesus. My God, look at what he says here. Y'all, I feel like preaching this morning. Y'all help me. He says, with thanksgiving, present your request to God. Your needs, your specific needs is what it means. By the way, you should have a request list for God. You should have a request list. God, this is what I'm asking you for. God delights when we bring him our requests. He loves to see us depending on him. He loves to see us so humble toward him that we say, God, I can't fix this. I can't change this. Lord, I'm bringing this to you. That's a good posture. God can't do anything with people who are so proud that they can't say they need him. Look at what he says will result. And the peace of God, which transcends all understanding, will guard your hearts and your minds in Christ Jesus. That's real good stuff. Paul says Now, if you will request from God what you need, and if you will do it specifically and with thanksgiving, the thing that will begin to happen is that what has been overwhelming you will begin to be underwhelming you. He says you will actually start to overwhelm the things that are overwhelming you by virtue of your prayer. So what will happen is the peace of God, which transcends all understanding, will begin to build a garrison around your heart and your minds. This is good stuff right here. He says you don't get the peace of God until you bring the request to God. And if you're missing the peace, it might mean that you need to stay a little longer in prayer. It might mean that you need to get a little more focus in prayer. It might mean that you need to devote a little more time to being alone with God. Paul says, because the guarantee is the peace of God. Now, here's what's interesting. He says, the peace of God, which transcends. In one sense, it means it's greater than. It's better than. But there's another very interesting sense to the word, to transcend. It means to take authority. He says, and the peace of God, which transcends all understanding, here's what he's suggesting, I think, is that the peace of God will begin to take authority over what you know to be true. In other words, it's not that the situation isn't real. It's not that the truth of your trial is not true. It may be true that you're going to lose your job next week. It might be true that your marriage is falling to pieces. It might be true that you're out of money. But Paul says, when you bring it to God in prayer and the peace of God begins to transcend your understanding, the peace of God will take authority over the thing you know in your mind that's making you worried and anxious, so that what actually is true can no longer control you, because the peace of God has taken over even that truth. So you're not worried about what's going on. You acknowledge it, it's real, you've given it to God, but the peace of God. So that's why people want to know, how can you still have your joy after all the hell that's been breaking out in your life? How can you still be grateful? How can you still bless God? How can you still walk with your head up? How can you still magnify the Lord in the mess that you're in? Because I've got the peace of God that has taken authority over all of my understanding. He says, finally, brothers and sisters, whatever is true, whatever is noble, whatever is right, I wish we had time to talk about this. Whatever is pure, whatever is lovely, whatever is praiseworthy, think about such things. He says, refocus your thoughts. Paul calls the Philippians out of their despair. He says, you got to begin to think differently. Paul says, part of the problem, part of the challenge, what gets us to a place where we're overwhelmed is the thoughts that we rehearse. Have you ever thought about what you've been thinking about? Isn't it interesting when you take the time to think about what you've been thinking about, what you've been reflecting on, what you've been rehearsing in your mind, all the scenarios that you've been sort of unwinding in your thinking, like this is going to happen, and that's going to happen, and they said, and I don't know why they said, and they looked at me like, and I don't know why they looked at me like, and this. By the way, can we talk about social media for a second? I'm not anti-social media. I just hate it. I mean, sometimes I love it, sometimes I hate it. You understand what I'm saying? Because the more people, here's the amazing thing about social media. We have more connections and we're more disconnected. We've got more digital devices. I got all of them. I got the watch, I got the phone, I got the iPad, I got all of them. But we keep massaging messages in our minds from people who don't give a freak about us. Excuse me, I'm trying. And we see stuff on social media and we're like, I wish I could do that. Well, how come I'm not there yet? Do they really think that about me? And Paul says, I want to help you stop being overwhelmed. Put your thoughts. Look at what he says. I'm going to just give you the list here. Finally, brothers and sisters, if it's true, think about it. He's speaking fundamentally concerning the truth of God. What does God say? Whatever is noble, whatever is right, whatever is pure, whatever is lovely, whatever is admirable, if anything is excellent or praiseworthy, what is worthy of praise? He says, start putting your mind on the things that's worthy of praise. If it's excellent, if it's good news, put your mind on it. Think about that. Think about what the Lord has done for you. Think about how good God has been to you. Think about how faithful God has been to you. Think about how much God loves you. He says, if you think about those things, he says, whatever you've learned or received or heard from me, I'll wrap it up right here, or seen in me, put it into practice, and the God of peace will be with you. I love that he says, first of all, you'll get the peace of God. He says, but if you get your mind right, you'll get the God of peace closer to you. He says, because as a man thinketh, so is he. He says, refocus your thinking. James said it this way. He said, draw near to God, and God will draw near to you. Maybe I need to turn my television off. Or maybe I need to turn off Netflix. Maybe I need to give social media a break. Because I got to fill my thought life with things that will bless my life. Come on and talk to me. That will encourage me and strengthen me. I need to think so much about the right things that I just begin to praise God in the bathroom. I begin to praise God in the living room. I begin to praise God while I'm driving. I begin to discover all the things that I can praise God that are praiseworthy. So much that the Lord has done for us. You overwhelmed? Paul gives us all the instructions. Rejoice in the Lord. Don't be anxious. Make your request to God. Refocus your thoughts.
I don't know. Hey, rejoice in the Lord always. And again, I'm going to say it like Paul did. Rejoice in the Lord. The Lord is near. Let your gentleness be evident to all. Don't let anybody push you out of your joy, no matter what goes on with this election. Hey, I want to invite you to continue your great support of Messiah Community Church. We are building and rebuilding. And in particular, I'm excited about focusing some attention on our next generation ministry to our students and our children. Would you give with that in mind tonight? And I'll tell you more about that in the upcoming weeks. Finally, I just want to say tomorrow night, we're having a special time called Now What? I'll be online at 7:30, Facebook Live, with four pastor friends as we talk about what are our next steps now that the election has taken place. Hey, I love you. I'm praying for you. Be encouraged and encourage yourself. Talk to you soon.
Thank you.